OJ Simpson. He died today from prostate cancer at the age of 76. The running back turned broadcaster turned pitchman for everything was a fixture in American living rooms for over decades of his career until he went on the run. In just moments, I'm going to speak with OJ Simpson's ghostwriter, the man who helped him with that semi-confession book, If I Did It, and also with Gloria Allred, who represented Nicole Brown's family through both trials. But first, Simpson's slow-speed sprint from police wound its way through L.A. and unwound the myth around that man, giving the country a glimpse of a jealous domestic abuser who police immediately suspected of brutally killing his ex-wife and her friend.
Okay, I'm going to have to interrupt this call. I understand we're going to go to a live picture in Los Angeles. Is that correct? Okay. This is Interstate 5, and this is courtesy of KCALR, one of our L.A. affiliates. Police believe that O.J. Simpson is in that car. Okay. Police believe he is in that vehicle. Let's pick up what the KCAL broadcaster is saying.
At this point, that the officers would do just about whatever they do in any type of a pursuit.
Now they're telling me that they believe that this vehicle is registered to Al Cowlings, one of OJ's oldest friends, a teammate at Southern Cal. And they believe that Al Cowling, who's the other person they're looking for, who was with OJ earlier today, they believe, again, they believe that this is the car. We do not know this is the car. Those are those cars following what is presumed to be the car containing OJ Simpson, now a fugitive from justice. The car is traveling at normal speed. The police reports that O.J. Simpson is in the passenger seat and apparently has a gun.
You get a glimpse.
The California Highway Patrol has now confirmed to CNN that it is definitely Al Cowling's vehicle. And they are almost certain that O.J. is in the passenger seat.
Pat, we're just now crossing the 605.
California Highway Patrol is also telling CNN,
so we're starting to
and
get
I'm repeating
up into
this
the,
to you as I hear
Long
it in
Beach
my
area,
earphones.
Actually north east Long Beach.
But again, OJ appears to be holding a gun to his head.
I can tell you that I have seen CHP officers stopping people from getting onto the 405. The southbound 405, as you know, is a parking lot with everybody stopped and out of the cars looking, waiting for this chase to come. But the Sunset Boulevard off-ramp is open, and it appears that they think that he might get off here. The whole way going north along the 405, it is an amazing sight. Along the right-hand shoulder, people have pulled over, many of them carrying signs such as signs reading things like Save the Juice, Go OJ. People are literally cheering him on as he travels northbound on the 405, and we can only assume that he plans to get off at sunset and go towards perhaps his home.
Craig, where is OJ Simpson now?
That I cannot tell you. I'm about a block away, and I have no monitors, but I can only assume he's inside the home. They did agree to allow him to speak with his mother, but there's one question that has been resolved here, and that is certainly that he is in police custody and unharmed, apparently.
What a day.
What a day.
One of the witnesses for the prosecution in that trial was Pablo Fenjves. He was Nicole Brown Simpson's neighbor, and he testified that he heard her barking dog the night of the murder.
I heard a very distinctive barking coming from somewhere to the south of where I live. And I was aware of it for maybe 5, 6, 7 minutes.
Was there something unusual about that dog barking that drew your attention to it?
It was fairly persistent. It was at a significant pitch. And as you may recall, I described it at the time as a plaintive wail. It sounded like a very unhappy animal.
That testimony was a critical part of the prosecution's timeline. But in a bizarre twist, decades later, Fenjves would then be asked to ghostwrite Simpson's hugely controversial book, If I Did It. That book was ultimately canceled by News Corp, the parent company of the publisher, HarperCollins. The Goldman family then got the rights to the book and worked with Fenjves to release it. And Pablo Fenjves joins me now. Pablo, thanks so much for joining us. You do have so many connections to this O.J. Simpson story. Let's start with your reaction to his death today.
Well, the thing that stood out for me was that in the entire time I spent with O.J. working on the book, he never expressed any remorse. And, you know, O.J. and I spent a fair amount of time together, and it was sort of an unusual relationship since I had testified against him, as you pointed out. But I didn't feel a great loss. I actually felt more for the Goldman family and the Brown family and for his children because of this, you know, checkered history, to put it mildly.
That testimony that we just played there was really a critical moment in this trial. But then for you to 10 years later actually even become a ghostwriter, why would you agree to do that?
Well, what happened was I got a call from the publisher, Judith Regan, and she said she had this project with O.J., and I said, you know, I testified against him. I'm completely the wrong guy for this project. But, you know, I'd done a number of bestsellers for Judith, and she trusted me, and she thought that if anybody was going to elicit an actual confession out of O.J., I might be that person. So initially, I said I didn't really want to go into business with him, and the legal team over at HarperCollins sent over documentation, and I saw that the deal was made with his children. And I figured, well, you know, if they get a little something out of this, it's not a bad thing. So I signed on and got on a plane to Miami and flew down to meet O.J.
He said,
the first thing
go ahead.
He said to me was, you know, the opening words, you know, we shook hands and he goes, have you ever heard of a man being put away for murder by a wailing dog?
Wow.
And so he was basically saying, I know who you are and I remember who you are. And we sat down and had lunch and, you know, got off to a slow start, but things took off from there.
Do you think that that was maybe one of the reasons why he agreed to do it? What was in it for him to have you, someone who testified against him, as his ghostwriter?
You know, I don't know if he gave it that much thought, you know, that somebody presented a deal to him, and I guess he thought the terms were agreeable, and he just, well, let's get this done. Let's do this job. And we sat down, and it's a form of therapy. Ghostwriting is a lot like therapy, you know, for the client. They sit there, and you walk them through their history. In this particular case, it was one chapter of his history that everyone was interested in, and so that's what we focused on.
So you said that he never expressed any remorse in the course of your working with him. Did you think he was guilty while you were writing this book?
Oh, you know what? At one point, you know, we're in the hotel suite working together, and we'd been working for a few days, and he said, you know, Pablo, now that you know me a little better and maybe like me a little bit, do you still think I did it? And I said, I'm sorry, O.J., I thought you did it when it happened a dozen years ago, and I still think you did it. And he exploded, and it was a lot of theatrics because a few moments later, he was laughing, and he said, I know you think I'm guilty. And he thanked me for being honest with him. And as I've said in the past, it wasn't, you know, like I'm a big, brave writer. It's just that we were in the middle of working on a book together, and if I had lied to him at that point, it would not have helped the project in any way. So I was just honest with him.
You describe him as someone who would explode at you in moments like that and then minutes later start laughing. I mean, explain to us, what kind of person, someone who spent a lot of time in book therapy with him, what kind of person really is O.J. Simpson?
Well, you know, for a while I thought, you know, maybe there was a lot of cognitive dissonance there and that maybe he really didn't think he had done it. But the more time I spent with him, the more I felt that he knew he had done it, because as we got closer to that chapter on the murders, it became harder and harder for him to deal with. I mean, it was a real struggle. I mean, he never fell apart, and he didn't cry, But he was, you know, he was angry and worked up as we got to that chapter. He kept saying, I hate this chapter. I hate this chapter. Do we have to do this chapter? And I said, that's the only reason we're doing the book. It's this chapter.
This chapter.
But the other thing that I thought was interesting, the chapter about the murders. And the other thing that I thought was interesting is, you know, he, in the book, when he talked about meeting Nicole, it was incredibly romantic, you know, a young waitress in a coffee shop in Beverly Hills. And then, you know, as we got deeper into sort of the marital issues and the abuse, he was just getting angrier and angrier and, you know, saying they turned me into the poster boy for wife abuse. And he basically was murdering her character in the book. Everything that went wrong in the marriage was her fault. And there was this sort of weird sense that, you know, he was saying, if I did it, she had it coming. And that was really chilling to me. And wow. It was, you know, it just showed what I was dealing with.
He at some point tried to turn the public against you. Why?
Well, I thought that was, you know, I'm sorry, I found it kind of amusing. What happened was the National Enquirer broke the news about the book, and suddenly there was a, you know, like a storm, and the Goldmans were on, you know, on the TV every day decrying the people who were involved in the book, and it wasn't pleasant. It didn't really affect me. I have a complete other life outside of the book business, but OJ decided, you know, if the book is a confession, you know, maybe Pablo did it. I mean, he, you know, he lives just, you know, 50 yards from Nicole's house, so, and he seems to know so much about the murder. So he basically was throwing me under the bus a little bit.